Okay, after several minutes, build the Android project. And if you notice here on the bottom one, there is no Gradle stuff, yeah, no Gradle process here. It means that the project building is done, yeah. The Android Studio is now ready to be used, okay? And if you notice here on the left side of the UI here in the studio, you will see the project structure, okay? This is the where you put your files in here, starting from the Java file or Kotlin files, which is control the logic and application flows, yeah? It within the Java folder and this in the package name, yeah, in the same package name that you specify in on brief on the setting up screen, and it already has one file as default, the main activity. Okay, when you double click it, you see the editor, code editor shows the main activity content, and then you can switch between a tab, yeah, between files that open, yeah, that open on the screen. So you can switch between tab here, and of course there's several files that you can put it within this folder as well. And when you switch to the layout screen like this, you will see this editor layout windows. It's similar like other visual programming, which is you can drag and drop a button and so on and so on. When you drag and drop a button, you can adjust the attributes in here and so on. We will talk about that later, yeah. And one most important thing on this UI is one, yeah, Loket. Loket is where you debugging your applications. So when you run the application, there's several texts that shows up in here, and then you can use that text to find out what's wrong happened with my application. So I'm going to show you how Loket looks like when you run the application. So it's a big debugging tools. It's dump a lot of system messages, including stack traces and so on. And if you confused at first time you see it, don't worry. Yeah, there's tons of text appear on the screen, but don't worry because you can still use this search input here to search something specific things about your applications. Somehow any applications has a lot of error. Yeah. So if you see a red text here, it means that there's some error happening right now when you launch this program, and it show you which one, yeah, what error that caused, what system that caused an error, and if it's not make your application crash, don't worry about that. Okay, so this is the important features of Android Studio to show you the log or debug log system. Okay, and about Gradle. Okay, what is Gradle? Gradle is actually a build system that has responsibility to build and compile Android source file. It means that it convert the KT and Java, it compiled it to become the executable compressed file, or APK, okay, APK, and then you can install this APK to the emulator or the real devices. And also the Gradle has responsibility to ensure all files, plugin, library dependency always update and working well. Okay, Gradle occasionally needs internet connections because it tries to connect to outside repository. If you look here on the Gradle script, okay, I'm going to minimize everything except this Gradle script. So you will see this build Gradle files, and it shows you several information like the compile SDK version. We use 30. Yeah, I'm going to show you about that later, and then the default config blah blah blah, and the target SDK version. See, the minimum SDK version is 19 because I already touched that at the setup screen. Somehow, if you want to change it, you change your mind, and then you want to make it to 16, which is targeting for Jelly Bean, you can do it in here. So you change it to 16, and don't worry to click the synchronize now button in order to rebuild your project and contact it and the Gradle will execute that and rebuild your project and you can start working with Android Studio. And the most important thing is dependency here is where you put some libraries that you are going to use inside application. You're going to write it in here, and I will show you several examples using external library in these courses. Okay. Let's see other stuff here. Work offline. Can we work offline in Android Studio? Yes, you can, but it's not recommended. Why? Because Android Studio need internet access to do the stuff like gradling process, run your codes, it use internet access. If you want to work offline, of course, you can go to the settings in here, change several settings, and work offline. Now we're moving to the SDK manager. Okay, so what is that? The SDK is software or a collection of library that help you build Android devices, and you can use the different SDK level to what you need yeah to accomplish your goals. So how we can access that? You can simply click this icon, this cube icon here, SDK manager, and then you will see the SDK, the available SDK that you can download and install. Right now I'm using the latest one, the Android R, yeah, the latest, the highest API levels. So it offers more features rather than previous API level. So if you want to develop for Marshmallow, doesn't mean that you need to install this one. Yeah, doesn't mean like that. So if I choose the highest API level, means that I can still develop for lower Android level, but I can still use the features that Android R has to offer. So bear in mind that if you want to develop for Lollipop, it's still okay you use R here or Oreo, okay, and you can still work on that one. So, but if you insist still want to use old API, you can download separately by tick this one and then click this download button. Okay, I think that's all about SDK. Let's move into the next one. The target market, it shows you the distribution of operating system in markets, and of course you can find on the statistic on the internet, on the Google. If you're targeting your application for Indonesian folks, Indonesian people, and then try to find out which operating system that majority installed on Indonesian people. Okay. Yeah, just like I said earlier that, so if you want to develop an application for Marshmallow, I need to use API level 24. Once again, it depends on what features that you want to use. For example, if you want to utilize the fingerprint features, you have to use API at least API level 24. However, if you just need to use regular tools, regular buttons, and you are to create a simple application, so you probably use lower API level. Kenapa, Pak? Higher API levels means that more widgets and features available. Yeah, higher API levels means that more widgets and features available to be used. Lower API levels means more gadget or device can install and use your application. So you can compare any Android version by visiting this site. Okay, now we are going to create an emulator. You are going to open the FED manager, actually located in here. the FAD manager. And then as you can see here, I already have one. If you want to create a new emulator, make sure you have lots of hard disk allocations, and then click this button, create virtual device. And then in this category, you can pick any of emulator devices that are available. Right now we only focus on phones, and then pick any of the pre-configuration already made, yeah, pre-made, yeah, pre-made configurations that listed in here. You can select any that you like. So I'm going to select the Pixel 2 with the size of 5 inch, yeah, with these resolutions, and density of pixel is 4420 dpi. It doesn't matter. Okay, press next. And then as you can see here, at the default, you have to download any of operating system that you want to install inside your emulator. In this case, already installed the R operating system. If you want to work with Oreo instead, you can download from this Oreo. Okay, and AVI means that this operating system, this system image, I mean, works on Intel. If you want to download others image, you can click x86 image for Intel to download any older operating system, and you can click the other image tabs in case you have AMD processor. Okay, AMD for unfortunately only Nougat available right now, yeah, the latest one. So work with Intel or work with AMD is okay, as long as you download the correct operating system. So press next button. Okay, you can name your emulator anything that you like. For example, my emulator, usually I put some information like this, R, Android OR, ROS, and then probably I typing another stuff like how many memory that I deploy on this emulator. So you can see in here, so as I deploy 2 megabytes and so on and so on. You can put any information you like from the FAD name. Okay, and sometimes you will see like HAXM error here. Yeah, you need to install the HAXM features to make this emulator works fine. So you can Google about it and make sure you already installed it. Okay, so as you can see, I created one emulator here, my emulator ROS, and then you can click this play button to launch this emulator. Okay, so you can see here we are starting the emulator. Yeah, you see this emulator now shows on the screen. It quite fast nowadays because there's some features that make emulator launch faster, especially related with your processor. Just like I said earlier, Intel have a virtualization technology that make emulator run faster on the Intel devices. AMD, I believe, also have Hyperthread virtualization stuff like that to make emulator somehow run faster on their machines. Okay, so the question is why we need to create several emulators, several system images. Yeah, because when we create an application, we want to test it out on different hardware. Yeah, we want to test it out, so it's cheaper rather than you buy the hardware one by one. Yeah, spread hardware, I mean. So it's cheaper to test it out on emulator. Okay, but somehow you still need to run project using the real device, because you will get better performance using the real device instead of emulator. And remember that emulator takes a lot of RAM on your computer, so be careful with emulator, guys. What I said here is, please run your emulator first when lecture starts. Means that it's not similar with like Android, Visual Studio, which is you can run your software and then you click close and okay, yeah, like that. But in emulator should not be close. Why? Because it takes a lot of times, a lot of seconds to load up the emulator up, and it loads up, it's burn up RAM. And when you close, open, and so on, yeah, you know what's going to be next. Yeah? So your UL eventually runs out of RAMs, and you have to close everything again, start up again, and so on and so on. So be careful about that. Emulator should not be closed during lecture. Open this up, and if you want to run some your program, you just simply press this run app button. It's going to build, yeah, gradual build running, yeah, as you can see it took some times, and then if done, the Android Studio will automatically install your applications to these emulators. Okay, now I'm going to pause right now, and I will be back after it's done